on, in addition to some of the great talks that you're seeing, we have a various contests, both from the vendors as well as some cool con-specific events like the wireless CTF and a mixture of TF2 and hacking called Hack Fortress. All of that's going on, so hopefully you're going to be able to participate in some of those things. In addition, 9 o'clock tonight. So after the conference talks are all over, and after you've had a chance to get some dinner, we'll be having a party here. You must have your Shmoocon badge to enter. So you'll need to enter from the top floor. And so again, it's 9 o'clock. There'll be music. There'll be dancing. There'll be a lot of smart people drinking and talking and hopefully exchanging some great ideas. So please come out and enjoy yourself. So again, 9 o'clock. You must have your Shmoocon badge to enter. So, to repeat what he said, at 5:15, Hackers for Charity will be having a silent auction in the, which room is that?
Chill-out room.
In the chill-out room. So where the Hackers for Charity stuff is set up now, that silent auction will happen at 5:15.
Only if Gage shows up.
All right, so with that, before we start this talk, I have, again, Shmoocon, the only conference with balls. We ask that you don't just hold on to these. They're not just a stress relief toy. These are a great way to stand up and make your voice heard. If for some reason you think these wonderful presenters are saying something wrong, stand up and let them know with a shmoo ball upside the back of the head. And I'm not going to throw it to the camera. So those of you sitting behind the camera, you're protecting it. You got it? All right. Also, another announcement. Ted is back. Ted has been at a large number of Shmoocons. He drives across the country to make sure that we're able to record, and so you guys can take a copy of these presentations home with you. So if you see a talk that you absolutely love and you want your coworkers to know about it, you can buy a DVD from Ted. The table's on the way out of this hallway. The vast majority of our talks are recorded by Ted, and you can get them for purchase. You could also purchase the whole set. So again, thank you very much for coming out, Ted. You can buy those at the end of the hallway. And with that, I have two more things to toss out. These are notebooks, so wake up. And of course, I threw it to the one person who was paying attention to his phone, not what I was throwing.
Oh.
And the second person in the room that was not paying attention and paying attention to this phone. All right. So from there, enough of my voice. I would like you all to please give a warm welcome to a talk talking about defeating Sandbox Evasion. So please give him a warm welcome.
Thanks, everyone. So hello, and thanks for attending our presentation. So, short disclaimer straight away. We've notified Cook Sandbox authors about all the flaws that we will present today, so we hope that they will be fixed as soon as possible. Okay, let's start, and I hope you will enjoy today's talk. Quickly about who we are. My name is Alexander Chailytko, and I'm leading a team of highly talented reverse engineers in Minsk, and here is one of them. Please welcome Stanislav Skuratovich. And today we have a lot of things to cover, so let's go straight to the point. Today we'll focus on bugs found in Cuckoo's sandbox, which may lead to detection and animation, and then we will provide fixes for them. In addition, we will do the same for different virtual environments, and finally we will present our sandbox detection tool called Invisible, which contains most of the detection and evasion techniques known to date. So our tool may be easily configured through JSON files, and can be used for assessment of your internal virtualized systems. Now we'll hand over the presentation to Stanislav, and he will guide you through the first part of it. Stanislav.
Okay, so let's discuss Cuckoo Sandbox. I'll start with some of the detection techniques. So evasion techniques I will leave for later. So the first one, and probably one of our favorite ones, is a technique called unbalanced stack. It may be applied to any type of user mode functions hooking that uses a similar hooking technique as Cuckoo Monitor does. So let's take a look what happens if functions are not hooked. So first we put function arguments on the stack. After that, we reserve some space on the stack for function local variables and function return address. And next, we put unbalanced stack canaries under the stack pointer. After that, the stack pointer is restored to its original state, and the function call is performed. As you can see, return address and function local variables does not overlap with unbalanced stack canaries at all. So after function finishes execution, we can easily check it for integrity. Okay, so let's consider that the function is hooked by the cuckoo monitor. So we move through the same steps as previously. And we perform a function call. However, this time, some space is used by the hook on the stack. And only after that, original function is called. So its local variables corrupted unbalanced stack canaries. So cuckoo monitor is detected, basically. So one of the proposed solutions is, of course, use of kernel mode hooking. But if you want to stay with user mode, we can use like few techniques, but I will show you one of them. So basically, we move through the same steps. And what we do now in our hook, we copy our arguments at the space. It is like lower than unbalanced stack canaries. And we have new return address. We have space used by hook and space used by function local variables. And as we see, it does not overlap with unbalanced stack canaries. So this detection technique can be easily fixed, as you see. So let's talk now a little bit about sleep skip logic implemented in cuckoo monitor. According to the first condition, only delays within the first gsleep max skip millisecond are skipped. So the second feature is usage of a global variable for accumulating skip delays. And the third feature is actually what implements skipping. So the real delay value is replaced with 0.1 millisecond. So sleep skip function is used by anti-delay execution routine. And gtime skip global variable is used by such functions like anti-query system time, getTCount, and other datetime functions. So let's see how infinite delay is handled by anti-delay execution routine. Basically, what we do, we call sleep with infinite delay. It goes down and calls sleep x function with infinite delay. And now sleep x converts it in an appropriate manner. And as we can see, with such a delay interval, thread will sleep forever. However, when we execute in like in the cuckoo environment, we have some problems. We have the same root till anti-delay execution. However, this time sleep skip function is called in anti-delay execution hook, and what it actually does, it replaces the infinite value with 0.1 milliseconds. So instead of sleeping forever, thread sleeps only for 0.1 milliseconds, so cuckoo is detected. The proposed solution for such a detection is pretty easy. We just to add one additional condition that checks the delay interval value. Let's take a look at the delay accumulation problem. So when we are calling sleep family functions, the skip delay value is added to the global gtime skip global variable. So and when we are calling functions related to the current system time, gtime skipped value is added to the current time in order to avoid detections by hooked into delay execution. So however, this leads to another problem. Malicious application can easily like get current system time and start waiting for some object for 100 milliseconds. At the same time, in the second thread, we can perform a sleep operation, for example, with a delay interval that equals to 3 days. And this delay interval will be added to the global gtime skipped variable. So what we do in the first thread, we simply query system time once again. And we compare the difference between current system time and previously queried system time. And if it's larger than some hard-coded values, then simply cuckoo is detected, because after waiting for 100 milliseconds, system time changed like for 3 days. So behavioral analysis problem we want to describe today is skipping delays only within the first gsleep max skip second from the start analysis. So let's take a look on it. What we can do, we can perform some time-consuming operations with that interval, like querying internet or decoding some data. So and after that, we just simply perform many large delay skips, and thus critical timeout of virtual environment is exceeded. And after that, we start performing malicious operations that will not be present in our report because virtual machine is already turned off. So we propose the following solution for that problem. We like skip all delays that are larger than some hard-coded value. And for smaller delays, we use the technique that is called sliding window. I will tell about it like the next slide. So what we do, we collect the number of hits for each delay within the last 10 seconds. And if the number of hits for a delay exceeds upper limit, then we simply skip the delay till the end of execution. As every technique, it has own pros and cons, of course. So pros are that all large delays are skipped, and that small delays and limited set are skipped as well. And it has like very high emulation rate in our test environment. But the cons are that some delays may not be skipped because of pretty high distribution between zero and gslip max skip millisecond. However, we can try to solve this problem by grouping delays into the swarms. So let's take a look on a small demo that will help us to better understand this technique. So all the information regarding specific delays is stored as a map entry. So threshold limit is set to 3 and sliding window set to 10 seconds in our demo case. So as you can see, we have an entry for 5 milliseconds. We have hit time list, and we have a Boolean flag skipped. So when application calls sleep function with 5 milliseconds, we simply add the hit time to the list. Threshold limit value is not reached, so we continue normal execution. Application calls sleep function with 5 milliseconds once again. So it's added to the hit time list. All the hit times are within the sliding window, so we continue normal execution. The same is with 2 millisecond delay. So after that, application calls sleep function with 5 millisecond delay once again. However, this time we can see that the difference between last and first entries is larger than 10 seconds. So we should remove the first entry. And as we can see, we have only 2 hit times, so we continue execution. We add a new delay to the hit time list. Threshold limit value is reached now. So we simply set the skipped flag. And now all 5 millisecond delays will be skipped till the end of execution. OK, let's take a brief look at the communication architecture between host and guest in Cuckoo virtual environment. On the host machine, the guest manager is responsible for sending requests to the guest machine. And in the guest environment, the agent is responsible for sending responses to the guest manager. So the agent model is responsible for communication with the host machine, as it was mentioned previously. Guest machine initialization, starting module, called analyzer that's responsible for malware tracking. Let's keep it in mind. So some of implementation details, agent listens on all interfaces on A1000 port. Actually, detection may be performed on any port. And it uses simple XML RPC server class for communication interface. So to detect running agents, thus compromising Cuckoo sandbox, malware can perform the following actions. It simply enumerates all listening sockets in the system, send crafted XML packet, and wait for response. If specific response was received, then assume that we are running in Cuckoo. So the example packet is presented on the left side, and example of received packet regular expression is presented on the right side. So the proposed solution is presented on the current slide. What we should do if connection request is coming from external IP, then we accept it. And if it comes from internal IP, then we reject it. So here we can see actual implementation of previously presented idea. We simply need to override verify request method and check if the client IP address belongs to one of forbidden ones. So So as it was mentioned earlier, analyzer model is responsible for initialization of analysis procedure and execution of analysis procedure, thus handling all the pipe messages coming from injected monitor and managing all the injections. So the analyzer is started by the agent model. And its location is calculated in the random way. So as we can see, the folder name is truly random. However, it contains two files, analyzer.py and analysis.conf, and it looks like a really simple way to detect cuckoos on box. What we need to do is simply enumerate all the folders on system drive, and we check if current folder contains one of these files. And if files are present, then we assume that we are running a cuckoos on box environment. This detection may be easily fixed by hiding the whole directory from enumeration using file system filter driver. Okay, so let's start with evasion techniques. This technique is pretty cool. At the beginning, we have to take a look on the way analyzer decides to inject or not to inject code inside the process. So if the analyzer process list contains a bit we want to inject a monitor, it basically performs some operations and returns without injecting. And if it doesn't, then it adds this bit to the process list and starts injection process. So as the bits are added to process list, they should be removed somewhere as well. So the analyzer checks if process is not alive. And if it's not, then it simply removes the bit from the process list. However, this branch will be executed only in case bit check is set to true. And we simply can force it to be false by specifying enforce timeout option. So as in Windows system, bits repeat quite often. We can create a list of already used bits. So when we create a bit, when we create a process, analyzer adds this bit to the process list. And what we do, we create processes in the infinite loop until we meet the bit that is already present in our list. So when we meet such a bit, analyzer process already contains that bit, so monitor will not be injected there, so cuckoo is evaded. We can perform any malicious activity we want. To fix the problem, we can simply handle kill command that is coming from the cuckoo monitor. We simply need to remove this bit handling this command. So we'll come back later how to deal with the situation with when timeout is not enforced. So thus terminated processes are removed from the process list. Okay, let's move to next evasion technique. On current slide, I want to show how injection is performed by cuckoo monitor if new process is created. So when process creates child process in suspended state, then process 2 command is queued to the pipe. And process 2 structure is created, and we see that we have main thread, main suspended thread with APC queue that's empty. So basically what analyzer does now, it fetches a command from the pipe and it starts inject up with specific parameters. And this inject application queues LDR load DLL address of LDR load DLL function that is responsible for loading cuckoo monitor inside the process. So let's see how Windows executes such APCs. So if thread is created in suspended state, it should be resumed to execute such APC. So basically, when monitor is successfully initialized inside that process, loaded command and sent via pipe. However, analyzer does not wait for notification from injected monitor. So, and as an analyzer already contains the bit, we can perform any actions we want as well because they will not be tracked. So because suspended thread will not be resumed. So we create process in suspended state once again. So we have a structure of child process with main thread, which is in suspended state and with APC queue that contains LDR load DLL function address. And what we do now is simply create remote thread and we can run anything we want because analyzer believes that monitor was already injected here. So lack of repeated injections and process 2 is not monitored. So we evaded cuckoo once again. Okay, another evasion technique I want to present is applied to the whole virtual environment, not for a single process. So analyzer contains instance of pipe handler that is responsible for handling incoming commands. So when command is queued to a pipe, analyzer simply fetches it and starts performing some actions. So what happens if analyzer is dead, basically? So we have an example of process running in the operating system. And analyzer is started by the agent. So both are Python scripts, so we conclude that we are looking for the parent child pairs, where both are Python applications. Thus, after killing child application, we have a pretty high probability that it was analyzer. Let's see a small demo how it works. We have the first pair. Both applications are whitelisted, so we simply skip them. We have a second pair. Both applications are Python, so what we should do now, we simply kill a child. And we have a last process tree that contains two pairs. So the first pair is OK. The second pair is OK as well, even the child application is Python, because parent is non-Python. OK, so we have data analyzer, so commands are not tracked in the system at all, so system is not monitored. Also, next evasion technique we want to describe is related to the Windows feature. The name of that feature is task scheduler. So basically, it's used for scheduling tasks for specific time or for specific interval. It's available on all versions of Windows, and it's the main feature that is not handled by Cocoa Monitor at all. So we have malicious application called process one, and we have a task database. So what we do now, we create a new task named the C task. Thus, task is added to the task database. And after that, we simply start the task. And this process can perform any malicious activities because process created as task objects are not monitored. OK, so next way to evade Cuckoo is also pretty simple. Monitor injected inside the tracked process initializes itself using DLL main function. Everything seems to be fine. However, one check gives us a possibility to skip the initialization routines. If a ignored procedure returns something except zero, the initialization routines are skipped. So let's take a closer look at the isignored process routine. If the module name is equals to one from the gignored process pass, then Cuckoo Monitor initialization is not performed. So we simply can evade Cuckoo once again. What we do, we choose one process from the process whitelist. We start the process, we inject malicious code, we change thread context, and after that, we just resume a thread. So whitelisted processes are not monitored. OK, the proposed solution is basically to remove all the process names from the process whitelist. So let's leave evasion techniques for a little bit and move to the next detection technique that is based on the number of occurred exceptions. So we can see the code that checks the number of totally occurred exceptions is equal to some hard-coded value. And if it equals, then we simply exceed process with error code 1. So the log exception function is called from the RTL dispatch exception hook if exception code is not whitelisted. So basically what we need to do, we generate exception max count plus 1 exceptions that are not whitelisted. And then we can simply force process to exceed with error code 1. So we create a child process. Child process simply generates exception max count plus 1 known exceptions that are not whitelisted. And if the RTL dispatch exception is not hooked, process second will exit with error code that equals to 0. However, if RTL dispatch exception is hooked by Cuckoo, the exit code will equal to 1. So Cuckoo Sandbox will be detected. So the last detection technique for Cuckoo Sandbox that we want to present today is based on the configuration file used by Cuckoo Monitor. It's used to perform some initialization steps. And the location of that file is well known, unfortunately. So as you can see, it's located on the C drive under Cuckoo pid.ini name. So detection technique is very simple as well. As it requires only a few steps. We create some process in suspended state. As we have a repeat of that process, we check the C drive for the presence of such a file for a few times with the delay. And if such file is present, then assume that we are running in Cuckoo Sandbox environment. So I will discuss fix for that problem a little bit later. And now I'll come back to the pit tracking problem. However, now enforce timeout is not set, so basically terminated processes are removed from the process white list. So how we can convince analyzer that process with reused pit is already monitored. So we can see the same code as previously. And we have a code from inject app. And we see that the file is dropped to its original location using move file function. Let's see prototype of this function. It takes like two parameters. However, it's clearly written in the MSDN that LP file new name must not already exist. So we have pretty the same code with a slight difference that process should be created in suspended state. So we like create process in the infinite loop until we meet the pit that's already present in our list. And as the cuckoo repeat is already present on the disk, move file function will fail. So monitor will not be injected here, so cuckoo is avoided once again. Okay, the solution for the described detection and evasion techniques is presented there. So injection process is initiated by the analyzer. So what we do, we generate a random name for the configuration memory object. So we write configuration here. After that, we start inject application with this shared memory object name. And inject application fetches this configuration from the shared memory object. After that, it injects monitor to the tracked process using reflective loader, allocates some space inside the process, and writes configuration here. And after that, it starts DLL main cuckoo monitor module with the argument that equals to config address. So basically, monitor will use this address as a configuration data. So now configuration file is redundant. And if we want to hide the data that's present in configuration, like by some memory patterns, we simply can encrypt the configuration data and put the configuration key like before it. So now I will pass presentation to Alex, and he will tell you about virtual environment detection techniques and the tool we have created.
Okay, thanks Stanislav. Now let's talk about the techniques that can be used to detect your virtual environment. So the first technique is based on tampering with date and time in your virtualized environment. The detection is based on three main assumptions. The first one is that in the real environment, the time on the system and should correlate with the web time, actually. We should not see a lot of difference here for obvious reasons. The second one is that we want to execute as much code as possible in a limited amount of time that we have, and so we need to utilize sleep skipping functionality. And the third one is that sometimes in virtual environments, the responses from the web services are emulated. Of course, if you are not using dirt line connection in cuckoo sandbox, and this is usually a bad idea. So let's see how this can lead us to the detection. We have approach number one, which performs the following operations. It gets the local time, then it gets a web time, for example, by sending a request to Google and parsing the response. In the next step, the process sleeps for 60 seconds, and then repeats the same operations once again, gets local time and web time. So we can assume that if the difference between the local time and the web time is greater than 5 seconds, we are running the virtualized environment. It can be either emulation of like web services or sleep skipping technique. Also, we can tell more specifically what happened by executing two additional checks. If we observe that the time delta between the first and the second function call is less than 60 seconds that we've tried to sleep, most likely something is emulated, probably web services or sleeps themselves. The second technique is based on the number of processor cores. This is already a well-known technique which checks if the number of processor cores is larger than one. As in modern processors, you wouldn't find anything less than two. However, on ESX services that are utilized to emulate malware like on a high scale, it is usually only single core assigned per machine to save the resources. So let's take a look at how the number of processor cores is usually retrieved nowadays by the malware in the wild. We can execute getSystemInfo API and get it from there. We can get it directly from PEB, or we can use getNativeSystemInfo API. However, all these can be patched, so we discovered a new technique which we haven't seen in the wild yet, and here it is. First, we get a number of potential cores by one of the standard methods mentioned on the previous slide. As each core presents a logical processor, we can set a thread affinity mask in a way that will allow our thread to run only of the specific core. Then we run CPU ID instruction with one in EX register, which allows us to get the ID of Advanced Programmable Interrupt Controller, or APIC, for that specific logical core, which we then put into the unique set. We repeat that step for each logical core. Finally, if the number of unique APIC IDs is less than the number of detected cores on the first step, then most likely something is being emulated, and we're dealing with a hooked function, basically, which tampers the number of logical cores, resulting in virtual environment detection. By the way, there is like no fix for that yet. Another well-known technique is detection by raw firmware table content. This technique was first implemented in the VMDU tool, and by the way, you can see the list of detected virtual machines on a VMD source code web page. So on previous systems, that content can be retrieved from the CSRSS service using anti-read virtual memory syscall. And on the Vista and above systems, content of those tables can be retrieved using anti-query system information syscall. The fact is that even this technique is well known for a long period of time, no solution have been proposed yet, so we've prepared one for you. As there are two different implementations, the solutions will also differ. So on previous systems, there are two different addresses with compromising data inside the CSRSS process. The first one is 0xC40's address. So this address is translated to the physical address, but the region is read-only, so we cannot patch it in place. What we should do instead is unmap this region, previously copying all the data to the temporary region, and then map the new region to that address, and finally copy the temporary region to 0xC40's address and patch the compromising data. The second address is 0xE40's. This address is also translated to the physical address, but the region is writable, so we can patch compromising data in place. On Vista and higher systems, we propose hooking the anti-query system information service. First, you should check if the system information class is equal to system firmware table information. Then parse system firmware table information structure and get provider signature and table ID fields. Then we check if the provider signature is either firm or RSMB. After that, we should call a regional anti-query system information routine. And finally, we can modify the buffer that will be returned to the user space, removing the actual detections. So let's discuss one more detection method. It's based on sending raw IOCTLs directly to the physical drive. So by sending the requests that you can observe on this slide, we can get the following information. Most of these virtual machines and virtual environments contain artifacts in that information, which will result in the detection. How can we fix that? Actually, only from the kernel mode by using the legacy driver. We hook dispatch device control functions, so all the needed IOCDLs will be handled by our hook, and we can return the needed values without actually querying the virtualized hardware. So we discovered a lot of new techniques for Cuckoo Sandbox as well as virtualized environments and proposed fixes for that. However, we realized that there is no tool on the internet at the moment that will allow you to assess your virtual environments in an easy, reliable way, and will contain the most recent up-to-date techniques. Also existing tools will only tell you like what they found, like VMD, for example, but know how to fix that. So we decided to create our own tool that will address all these drawbacks. So more than that, anyone can contribute to our tool since it's open source, and everybody can do this even without the touching the source code. I will explain that later. As I already mentioned, we wanted a generic tool that will cover a lot of different environment actions, techniques, and will propose fixes for them. We wanted it to be easily extendable, so the support for new virtual environments can be added quickly. As Cuckoo Sandbox is the most prevalent tool used for automated malware analysis, we wanted to include the detections for, of it as well. And in addition, we wanted to create an ability to introduce new detection techniques, not through modifying the source code, but by using the JSON configuration files, so the whole community can contribute towards the development of that tool. Finally, we wanted a user-friendly report about the checked environments that can be shared without the organization among the purely technical guys, as well as high management if needed. So we support three specific environments, such as Cuckoo Sandbox, VirtualBox, and VMware, and also a number of generic detections that can be assigned to any specific environment. Generic detections may be based on a lot of stuff that you can see on that slide, basically including registry keys, devices, files, processes, like MAC addresses, network adapters, and all that stuff that you can see. So it's really flexible. For example, let's take a look at the configuration file content, specifically the part that utilizes registry key detection. As you may notice, we can specify more than one artifact, so the search will be performed on a set of artifacts, which is quite useful. We can also add the key recursive, so it will allow us to enumerate all the subkeys in the specified key, and configuration files also support the, all the mentioned artifacts in the same manner. So to add a new detection artifact, we just need to add a new entry in the configuration file. And there is absolutely no need to do recompilation of the tool itself, since like it will get the new configuration file on the fly. As an example, we can add such a section in the configuration file to detect virtual environments based on a specific device. OK, let's move on to the output interfaces. Here's a list of output options. We can output the report. This is the most user-friendly version of the output. You'll get a nice HTML file with a description of detection techniques and with the devices on how to fix your environment. Also, the second option is to output to the console. This method contains additional debug information if you need it. The third option is to generate a domain with a specific name per each detection with detected or not detected top-level domain. This is especially useful when you do not have physical access to or full control of the tested environment. So you can find detected methods of evasion in the Cuckoo report in behavioral analysis, network operations, DNS. And finally, we can generate a file for each specific detection technique. The file name will contain the detection name plus detected or not detected postfix. So this method is also the most convenient for checking the environments where you don't have a full control, and you can just upload files for analysis, such as virus total, for example. So let's sum up. We presented a lot of new detections and evasions for Cuckoo Sandbox today. We've developed the easily extendable tool for virtual environment assessment, which supports easily interface for adding new environments, addition of new detection techniques using configuration files, and also multiple output options. So the most important part is that our tool is available as open source. And we've prepared the demo, so now I will switch to laptops and we'll show you how the fixes that we've implemented are working. So basically, we've implemented two different Cuckoo sandboxes. One is original vanilla Cuckoo sandbox, 2.0 RC1, and another one is modified Cuckoo that we've where we modified and fixed all the bugs that almost all the bugs that we were talking about today. So, as you can see, there are two machines prepared. Coco modified and Coco regional. And here is the web interface. So we select our invisible tool that is used for assessment of the virtual environment. So we're submitting it to the one Coco. So it starts the, it has also a separate worker, so it starts worker modified. And also let's submit to the original Coco the same file. So it starts another worker, which is original worker. What it will do actually is run our tool. You can you will be able to see the output to the console actually. So you see a lot of red stuff straight away in the original Coco. It means that it detects the different techniques that we've just presented. We just need to wait until it will finish. So, and I'll show you the report in the end. Let's see how the modified Coco is doing. It's not doing really well, actually, for some reason. Probably we will need to restart that. But yeah, this is live demo, so demo gods is like, we should pray for that, first of all, you know. Okay, so this one is finished. We just need to for Coco to finish the analysis and running all the modules so we can extract our report from the virtual machine. Okay, I think I will probably just restart the modified Coco. Okay, let's see what happens. We can do a Q&A session in a time while this process will finish. So if you have any questions, yeah, please.
So you both work for Checkpoint, right?
Yeah, that's right.
And you're aware that Checkpoint sells a sandbox application, right?
We have the thread emulation sandbox.
How does that fare against this?
How is this what?
How does your tool fare against your own sandbox?
Can you find your own sandbox?
Ah, okay, I've got your question. So basically, yeah, so the question was, like, the Checkpoint has, like, a thread emulation product, and it's used to, actually, to emulate the documents, like PDFs, files, and also we recently included the emulation for executables. So I'm not from the team of the TE, so from the thread emulation team, so what I can say is that we run our tool, but it's not applicable to it, basically, because it's not based on Coco. So we don't have such detections that we've presented, basically. And we're using the different virtualization solution. So I would not say what one, but it's different. So it's basically not detecting it just because it's not applicable to it.
Yes.
Yeah, we have. No, we don't have a binary distribution. So the question was, like, do we have any releases? We have a source code. You can compile it yourself. We don't have, like, we don't compile binaries. So no. Maybe we can, like, do that. Okay.
Evasion
Okay, I will show you the report right now because the original Cuckoo, Vanilla Cuckoo report is ready. So let's take a look at it and you will see the answer to your question. So the question was, what is the ratio of the generic detections and the Cuckoo Sandbox detections? So as you can see, the first goes the Cuckoo detections. So the red stuff is bad stuff because it means the detection. So you see a lot of detections like unbalanced tag, delays accumulation, infinite delay, like whitelisted processes, race exceptions, a lot of that, PID reuse. And generic section is less than that. So you can see that it's detection by disk size, drive size, RAM, processor counts, and also some detections for VMware because we're using VMware as a virtualization solution. So hypervisor port, hypervisor bit, control stats in the registry, so a lot of stuff. And zero for VBox, virtual box, because we are not using virtual box here. So let's take a look at this. Is ready, so it's completed, but it's not ready yet. So we just need for it to finish. It will take some seconds. Yes, now it's completed. Let's take a look at that. This is from the modified Cuckoo. As you can see, a lot less detections, only like three from Cuckoo. Only for delays accumulation, function hooks, and suspended thread. Also zero generic detections in our Cuckoo, and like only two in VMware, only hypervisor port enumeration and drive VMware drive model. And we have like fixes for that. We just not incorporated them in our Cuckoo yet, but we have fixes for all this stuff that is left. So yeah, let's continue with the Q&A. Okay, so the question was like how many malware is actually using the evasions and how many is using more than one. Actually, we see a lot of usage of evasions for the last year and year and a half. So almost every major malware is using evasions, and they're using not the single technique. Usually they're using it in like in bundles basically. So we can see like from 5 to 10, mostly evasion techniques in a single malware. So I think this answers the question. Please.
I have a question about what are your thoughts on AV leaks, and how does your tool, which works on sort of an open source engine like Cuckoo, compare to AVE, which does more granular enumeration on closed source sandbox?
As far as I understood, your question is like, why are we assessing the Cuckoo sandbox and not the closed source like sandboxes? Is it true? Yes? Okay. So, yeah, basically, first of all, we're using Cuckoo in our private internal project of my team. So, we're basically improving it for our internal needs, but we're also sharing what we found with the community. So, and our tool is an open source. And this is the main reason why we are assessing that. So there is like a crossing of the interest, actually, because we're using Cuckoo Sandbox internally, and we're trying to improve it, but we're also trying to share the information.
You guys have any detections for Hyper-V?
Hyper-V, actually, we have them in our knowledge database. It's not being implemented in our tool yet, but it can be easily added like with the technology that we've just talked about with the JSON configuration files, because like most of the Hyper-V detections are based on some kind of like ports or devices presented or some registry keys. So more specific detections, no. As I said, because we mostly like use VMware and Cuckoo Sandbox in our environment, but it can be easily added. So yeah. Yes, please. Yeah. Yeah. So you mean if the malware, for example, will infect the machine that is running on the AVS, how it will define that it's running on the, so how it will differentiate run that it's running on the IVS, which is
very.
So as far as I understood your question is like, how malware is actually, AWS as far as they're concerned is using the Xen hypervisor. Also, there are like not a lot of stuff which are consumer grade or I don't know desktop grade is being run actually on AVS. So most of these are servers, and there is like servers are running mostly on a Linux. So there are a lot of really low percentage of malware is actually trying to infect that. So we've seen some, but it's not a lot. Actually. Any more questions? Yeah, please. I can't hear you. Can you?
Are they expected to fix the problem?
Is Cuckoo going to fix the problems you found?
We don't know.
Not yet. But we are willing to cooperate, so yeah. We have a stop sign, so we need to stop right there. If you have any questions, please approach us in the corridor. Thank you.